What was the motivation behind starting DFE? And it has been 18 years since DFE has started. So how it all started, and post 18 years, what is the feeling after like this so long time?
Okay, so that is like a very loaded question with a lot of long answers rather than a short answer. But just to give you an idea that in 2002, when we started this organization, now of course it sounds very long. It also sounds like who used to talk about digital at that point of time. And that too, name sounding Digital Empowerment Foundation sounds like a yesterday's plan, not 20 years before plan, right? So, but I had a little background of being into IT journalism and media, and I also started the HindustanTimes.com, the internet division of Hindustan Times. So I had a IT journalism in print and then new media. And then I had started a software company which was mostly making the websites and the web version of all the big media houses like Tehelka, Hindustan Times, Times of India, Midday, Amar Ujala, Rashtriya Sahara, and so on and so forth. So I had a lot of exposure what internet could do and what internet is relevant to and all that. But the real change was when I was, writing my first book, co-authoring my first book called Internet Economy of India in 2000, 2001, and between those years. And when the book came, and then we certainly did a lot of research. And one word that stuck into my mind called digital divide. Incidentally, in the COVID time, everybody is talking about digital divide. But at that point of time, digital divide came, and it got stuck in my mind because, it is stuck not in a general value of or a scope of digital divide, but what I realized is the role of information in the people's life, and what I realized is that, India's poverty, India's backwardness, or India's economic deprivation, or all those things, what you call poor, is not because they are poor because of economic losses or because of the poor resources or anything else, but it was purely because of poor information. So we were less informed, we were blocked informed, we were not rightly informed, and all that. So information is the key, and I realized that if everybody is seamlessly informed and seamlessly get connectivity or linkages to create content and inform others. To information and from information, if it is proper, then there is a lot of problem of poverty, backwardness, equality, and all those things will go away. And
Yeah.
that really became my nirvana point. And we thought that no, let's work on something how we can do information empowered society and community, and we realized that the only way you can make information rich society or information enabled society is by making internet reach to everyone or connectivity reach to everyone. That's how it all started. And obviously initially there was no money, nothing, so we started with more what you call as research kind of work, more writing kind of work, more advocacy kind of work. And we got also associated with United Nations in 2003 when UN when WSIS was announced by Kofi Annan, World Summit on Information Society. So that gave us further exposure of what is information society, and that also linked us into an international platform, which actually turned out to be a boon. And you must have heard of that. There are various awards that we instituted,
Yes.
Montana Award, M Billionth Award, ENGO Challenge, Social Media for Empowerment Award. So all these award took place and got born under World Summit Award, which was actually originally created under the UN's WSIS framework. And I was associated as a grand jury member and also as a board member. So that gave us a lot of perspective. But what we realized and what is our main focus and motivation has always been that how do we work to the person at the last one? You know, that's important. And so rural India certainly became our den, became our focal point, became our, you know, playground. And we also decided that we will not only just talk, but we will also do work by our hand. So you must have realized that after government, we are the only biggest organization in the country who work in taking digital to the grassroots or to the people in the hand. Yes, I mean, yeah. We just don't only talk and we take the things there. Those were the some of the background that we started with. And then, of course, you know the history, you know everything. So you know, that is how we grew. We certainly, you know, are a gradually growing organization. We are an organization which has grown very, very fast to reach to 23 states and 130 districts and more than 700 locations all over the country. And we work primarily in creating an infrastructural access point. Digital access point for the masses, you know, and then of course everything gets embedded.
Thank you so much, sir, for answering that. And from your answer itself, you mentioned about the digital divide, and I would come to that in the later part of our conversation. And also you mentioned that you guys are the second largest after government in terms of making sure that the digital infrastructure reaches to the last mile. So I would like to start my first question with that itself. DF is one of the pioneers to enable access and build capacity of masses in the digital infrastructure. How does digital empowerment play its part in education?
This is an interesting point. You know, we actually don't play any part in education. You know, the way conservatively and the way traditionally seen education, you know. So we don't get into content building. We don't get into quality check. We don't get into curriculum. We don't get into, you know. So we don't per se get into education. But we play a huge role in education from a different perspective. What we do is that if you look at the whole, population which is out of school, if you look at the whole population who are in school but in rural India, if you see the perspective that most of these big population people under living below poverty line and above poverty line, and those people who are tribal, those people who are scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, minorities and all that, you will see that their access to education is extremely limited, either because non-functional school or because of non-availability of basic infrastructure or because of their non-affordability or because of their inaccessibility or because of the typical social differences, if you are a Dalit, you usually do not get proper food in the midday meal, you know, or people will not sit with you and those kind of discrimination. So what I'm actually trying to say is that we believe in providing digital infrastructure accessibility to the people who are looking for education as an alternative way of looking at education. May not be alternative education, but alternative way of looking at education. So, in all our centers, people come to access education on their own. They do their homework, their classwork, their project work and all that. But beside that, we have taken education in our hands from the perspective is that you are properly literate and functionally literate and educated to use digital devices to access best content or whatever content you want. So we will work on that. We will make sure that you are digital financial literate. We will make sure that you are digital literate, you're digital functional literate. We'll make sure that you are digital enough literate to access health solutions. You will make sure that you are digitally enough literate to do business online. We will make sure that you are digitally enough educated to try your skills online. You know, you are digitally enough skilled or educated to access your rights, entitlements, schemes. You know, you are literate and educated enough to apply online or do transactions online. So what we do is that we are the nuts and bolts of education. You know, we work on how we create the nuts and bolts of education to be available and provided to the people for which we do enough mass capacity building and training and skills.
Exactly. And that is what is required in today's day and age. Like people don't actually know how to access the right information from the available sources. And I guess DF is playing that part for rural India. The next question would be like the first when DF started, like, and it's one of the projects was Gyanpedia.in in 2005, where you aggregated content created by government teachers and students. How have things changed since then in terms of content use for rural India?
So you would see that if you go back to Gyanpedia time, it was somewhere around 2005, right? About 4 or 5 when we had created Gyanpedia, and as you said very clearly in your note, that Gyanpedia is nothing but a web portal or the aggregation of content created by children and teachers in rural India. We still believe that content created by the masses is more important than content created for the masses, you know, because then you are creating consumerism also, you know. But when the masses create content that is creative, that is diversified, that is localized, that is, contextual, and so on and so forth. And it's always good to produce rather than just be user, you know. So that was the focus. But at that time, you know, computers were being distributed a lot in a lot of schools, but there was no connectivity or internet connectivity. So it was basically offline digital content access, you know, or offline, computer access points. So therefore, creating a web portal or a Gyanpedia was very interesting approach that we wanted to, number one, wanted children to give them the power to produce content, and not only that, produce content, but also give visibility to their content. Number two, we wanted to create a aggregation of content, produced content by the children and teacher in a web domain so that one can use it, everybody can use it, you know, and then rest of the people got also inspiration. And then gradually you must have seen that how everybody has started creating content to put it on a web domain or a digital domain, on a public domain, on digital public domain, and so on and so forth. Gyanpedia was the beginning of the assertion that the future of PDA is the future of education, or the future of content, is creating public PDA, you know, public access content created by public. And you know, at that time, Wikipedia, nobody even knew. But now Wikipedia is now seen as a very strong, believable resource of content, you know. In fact, now people aspire to be listed in Wikipedia.
Yeah.
So that, you know, it can be, they are more searchable than anybody else. So that is very interesting how we came. And then obviously that also gave us a boosting that even a school-based teacher and a student should not be isolated to be the producer of content. And that is the reason why we started creating community information resource centers, you know, all over the country and in at a village level, so that not only students but everybody can come there and access internet, access digital, access information, but also get an opportunity to produce.
Thank you so much, sir. A follow-up question to this is like, sir, like since 2005 and when you started Gyanpedia, and it was just the beginning of a huge revolution in terms of how the content was coming online. What are some of the challenges you still feel that are impacting the access and use of digital content for the people? What are some of the challenges, sir, you still feel are impacting the access to digital content?
The biggest hurdle is connectivity itself, access itself. You know, now if you really look at, look at the institutional access only. If you see 1.4 million schools, government school in India, do they have computer centers? No, they don't. No. Do they have all of them internet connectivity? They don't.
No, they don't.
It's very simple. The first question itself is why they don't have digital access. Access more in terms of hardware, software, and internet connectivity. Three, all three together. And the fourth will be with bandwidth, so that you can access also freely, seamlessly, and at your will. You know, it should not be 9.6 kbps or 2G or something like that, you know.
Definitely.
So that is very important that one should realize. So the biggest hamper, I would say, is non-correlation of basic infrastructure, consideration of basic infrastructure, digital infrastructure as a basic necessity, number one, and the lack of correlation to education. I mean, for example, we should have done connectivity as a human right or as basis, number one. Number two, it should have been embedded that every school should have, you know, 2 Mbps or 10 Mbps or 100 Mbps connectivity without any hindrance and a computer lab. This should have been done 20 years before or 15 years before. Even till today, it is not done. And unfortunately, till today, it is not even part of NEP also.
Yeah, that's not. Yeah.
You know, so non-consideration of digital as a basic necessity itself is a biggest hurdle, because agar government paise nahi lagayegi, if the government doesn't put money or doesn't put will through its act or rules or schemes, how will people do? You know, how will people do? Abhi at the moment, at the COVID time, suddenly government is also saying that let's go all online for education. This is a good movement to create pressure that now online access will increase and the pressure of meaningful connectivity or a working connectivity will increase. But the point is why we were not ready for it. Because the readiness itself will take another 5-10 years. And we can't afford it. And that's the reason why all the students are devastated.
Exactly. And sorry, like you very rightly pointed that because of COVID, now we are realizing the need of the digital infrastructure altogether. It came just like a sudden thing, and a lot of students are facing problems in actually accessing their basic education. That you guys have started an initiative called Digital Daan, which has emerged from the existent digital divide in the country, and which started basically because of the COVID. Can you tell us something more about this initiative and what are the impact numbers we are looking at in the coming years?
Okay, so Digital Daan, as you said very clearly, that there is a huge digital divide that is existing at the moment and being highlighted because of the COVID. Because of the COVID, you are now left to be dependent on mostly digital, right? Since you are dependent on digital, you are suddenly also realizing that there is a huge digital divide, right? And since there is a huge digital divide, you are wondering about the intensity of it. You didn't know the numbers earlier because you had a school, you were going to school, you had market, you were going to market. Now you want to buy online, now you want to read online, now you want to write online, now you want to do transaction online, you know, now you want to do video call online, you know. For every thing, there was an alternative, physical alternative. Now they don't have it. So, you know, we thought that government alone or private sector alone cannot do it or may not be able to do it, you know. So therefore, we as an organization decided to, upgrade our commitment and actually said that why don't we start talking to people and asking for donation of their second phone or a third phone or a used phone, which they don't need it, or they can, you know, they can actually, share it, you know. So that is how the scope started. And we thought that India has got 400 to 500 million smartphone penetration. Okay, if so much of the penetration is there, then why don't we ask them, because most of them are concentrated in urban India. So they might be using the second and third phone. And that is how we decided that. So we decided that let's take education a holistical problem, not only the device problem. So we realized that device is the first thing that they don't have it. You know, we cannot do too much about connectivity, except few places we can do Wi-Fi connectivity and all that. But major connectivity issue has to be resolved by ISPs, internet service providers, or the government or the private sector, you know. But at least at the device level, is it possible that we generate some interest from the donors? So we launch it from the perspective that we will collect the donation, then we will distribute it through the centers that we are present, so that okay. We have the proper channel of identification of the needy people and also the proper channel of identification of how it can be maintained and managed and how the usage is taking place, so that we can also keep the data. But when we launched, we realized that everybody talked about it. You, me, everybody. I mean, it got good coverage. Everybody was interested. Everybody appreciated. But actually, the conversion on sending the devices or couriering the devices or donation is not as much as it is being forwarded, you know. So it's something like you forwarded to 500 people, but you yourself haven't donated. You know, I have forwarded to 1,000 people, but I myself has not committed anything. You know, so however, we are getting more interest from the seekers. So we are every day getting 5-10 schools or education centers or NGOs or individuals who work in the social sector, where they are saying that we need computers, we need devices, we need blah, blah, blah. So we are actually compiling all of them. We are actually trying to also convince some of the corporate houses to donate their old machines and all that. It is a work in progress, but our target is to mobilize 1 million devices in the next 3 years.
Okay.
Because we feel that, This entire pandemic is going to create and keep the impact, adverse impact for at least 2 to 3 years. So and the access is not going to be readily converted into something that is available for everyone. So what we are planning is actually that we will try to raise 1 million machines or the devices, and we'll distribute it across the country, which is nothing actually, because literally 320 million children are there. You know, how many millions of devices would be available? I won't even, I'm sure not even, 10, 20 million devices will be available.
Yeah, definitely. You know?
So there is a huge requirement of 1 million is nothing from that point of view. If we achieve, I am very, very skeptical about that, whether we will be able to achieve this number. But at least we have made a target for ourselves, because so that we can keep on pressure on, you know. But we are also converting under the Digital Daan initiative. We are also converting and facilitating all our centers into a access point, you know, for all the local students in a scheduled manner. So rather than giving them a device, if I give a device, I'll have to give one device per house. But if I'm using my center with 10 computers, then I can schedule that 10 students can come and sit for 1 hour, then they can go. Then again, 10 students can come and sit and go. And on that period, they can do their online classes or homework or classwork or project work. So at least this will be a public facilitation for education access for the poor people who live in village level. So that is what we have started doing at the moment.
Great. This is something really required. And in today's time, as you mentioned, like for like 320 million children, like not more than 10 to 20 million have the access to the digital devices. And a million also would be just like a drop in the larger ocean. But it is like what I feel is the way to go and just the start. So DEF, sir, has a lot of different projects revolving around education and empowerment. Are there any new upcoming projects of DEF which focuses on school education?
And when you said school education, what do you mean? Primary, secondary,
primary, higher secondary. Like primary and middle, like till 8th standard?
No, we don't have any focus in that area.
Okay.
We don't want to focus in that area at all, because what is happening is that digital gadgets or digital connectivity or digital everything is more conducive or more contextually relevant to the slightly bigger children, above 10, above 20, above 13, 14 or something, you know, then it becomes relevant. And if you go to rural India, then even though you see that the children who are drop out or get into adolescence, they are more relevant. So okay. Therefore, our focus is always on adolescents and above as far as the digital integration in their life.
Okay.
You get my point?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Yeah. But from that perspective, we have a lot of focus. For example, Digital Academy.
Okay.
For education and skilling. So all our educational products, all our training and capacity building, all our skilling, experiences and products and the materials are going to be integrated. Actually, the Digital Academy is more like going forward for rural India to give them a chance to think that if they want to go digital for education, what are the building blocks that they need? So we want to provide all of that.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for answering that.
Sir,
what according to you should be the top priority action of all these stakeholders that are involved in education and technology space for tackling this huge digital divide? Which is existing in the country. And I'm coming from a point of view from the organizational point of view for like all the edtech industry point of view.
So listen, it is very interesting. If you talk about the edtech industry, you will see that most of the edtech industry is working only on content.
Yes.
You know, hardly any edtech company would be working on access, or for that matter, device, or for that matter, any of those kind of things. You get my point?
Yes.
So I would say at the time of COVID, the way digital divide issue has been highlighted, I would say that corporate, government, and everybody should work collectively on access. Access for connectivity, access for device, access for space, access for training, capacity building and netiquettes, and social behavior.
Okay.
So I am saying that there has always been enough content. You know it. You know, there has always been enough content. So there is no need to work on content. You need to work on how do we make content reach to the people, right? Or how do people access the content in a low cost, affordability and all that. So I think what we should work on, can we talk to OEM level or a device level to tell them that can you give for education purpose, if I am buying devices, can you give 50% discount or 20% discount or 30, whatever, you know, something like that. We should work on, talking to ISPs and the government that is it possible that the connectivity cost can be subsidized for students or for education purposes, you know, or enhanced. So if I get normal, I get, let's say, 100 rupees connectivity every month, can I get 100 rupees connectivity for 200 Mbps or something like that or whatever. You know, either more bandwidth or if the same bandwidth, then at a lower cost, you know, can we afford it? Can industry work on providing soft loans, you know, or interest-free loans for buying devices, let's say, you know, or buying connectivity? Can also parallelly government work in creating public spaces with digital devices for public usage and access in a public mode, in a community mode? So those kind of things are very, very important that we should work on, you know, and that is required. That is the requirement of the time. The requirement of the time is not rehashing the same content and making it available or making more advertisement that, you know, we are COVID, embedded. How are you COVID embedded? You know, only your advertisements say that. It doesn't reach to my house, you know. For example, everybody is now talking on video. Everybody. But for video, you need a good device, you good smartphone, good connectivity, good bandwidth. So why don't you work on this? Because in a digital divide era, earlier, you know what, most of the people were working online education in an e-learning manner. But now everybody is working on online education in a interactive manner. Like you and me are talking, you are a teacher, I am a student, you know. We are talking like the way we were doing in the classroom. So now the scope is more. I mean, it is not on, when you come on video, it is not only that you are accessing content online and doing e-learning, but you also have a chance of, you know, doing teaching on WhatsApp, doing teaching on Zoom, doing teaching on video, doing teaching on calls, doing teaching on radio, doing teaching on telephone call. Everything is possible. So if all those are possible, you need to work on how do you enable that. That is the most important part.
So the four X's which you mentioned are like gonna surely stick with me, and like that is something like a very interesting part which you mentioned, that X's in different terms is what is required in terms of the digital X's to tackle this digital divide. Very recently the new education policy came, and how will NEP 2020 impact in bringing the digital divide? Please share your thoughts on this.
I would say, considering digital divide is a big issue, and considering that NEP 2020 more or less and broadly allows education with diversity, it allows it. It has broken the system of 10 plus 2 plus 3 also. It has also created more openness to having your own education system or alternative education system and things like that. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So now it is very conducive to use digital as an infrastructural enabling tool to do an independent education, self-learning education, self-motivated education, self-designed education, you know, do-it-yourself kind of education, action-based education, activity-based education, Montessori kind of education, mentorship-based education, rather than purely teacher-student kind of education. Definitely. Teacher-student kind of education and curriculum-based education has not done good to our country.
That's true.
What we need to figure out is that how we take advantage of NEP as an approach to openness and use digital as the infrastructural and the basic tool. Like NEP says, the foundational pillars of NEP is access, equity, affordability, quality, and accountability. So out of these five, I will choose access, affordability, and equity. So if you have access, you can have your own education. If you have affordability, you can have your own education. If you have equitable approach, that means if I'm a Dalit, I don't get discriminated. If I'm a minority, I don't get discriminated. If I am a poor, I don't get an issue of access and affordability. Then, you know, digital is the best medium, you know. Digital is the best medium. And if you do digital, and here you can take example of goal program of DEF, and you can go to goingonlineasleaders.in. This is a woman program of tribal women program, where a mentor of, let's say, your sister or your mother is a mentor living in a city. And then there are five tribal girls who are mentees. And they do WhatsApp call every weekend. Okay. And they do chit chat. They just do informal chit chat. But because of that, they have got leadership, they have got openness. All these mentors have started teaching them. They have started guiding them how to become smart, how to be confident, how to speak, how to listen, how to learn, how to access. Everything they have started on their own. And no cost involved as far as they both are concerned. I mean, we have some management cost, and then Facebook adopted this one and they helped us to launch with 100 tribal girls and 25 mentors. And then finally, Tribal Ministry of Tribal Affairs has adopted this program and launched it at a national scale.
That's great.
Yeah. So this is an example of education in an open manner, you know, informal manner, and still using digital and without making content digital.
That's the last part is important. It's basically access again. Yeah.
So that's what I would say about NEP, not long lecture of how many percentage of education is not reached and how many people are illiterate and how numeracy is being challenged and how, you know, people don't pass their exam. I don't think in a digital era with a digital infrastructure, with a open learning system, you need to prove a point that I know numeracy or not.
Yeah, that is something people are now figuring out, and I'm sure like they would come to the realization of that very soon. Right. With that note, sir, thank you so much for your time. It was nice talking to you and to know a lot more about how you think in terms of digital access and how people can actually leverage out of that thoughts for education as well. Thank you so much.
Sure.